Good day, everyone. So we are meeting after 2 weeks this time, because last Saturday was Ganesh Chaturthi. In fact, I took advantage of the long weekend and I went to a place called Aurangabad, which is now called Chhatrapati Shambhaji Nagar. And I did a two-day workshop in counseling for an NGO. I was very impressed by the fact that even in small towns, people had come, you know, from their branches in Jalna, Nanded, Bid, different places to learn counseling and to practice counseling in the offices of those NGOs. So it's a very good sign that people are becoming more and more aware of things like human behavior, interpersonal relationships, and this and that. This was unheard of earlier. So things are looking up. Now, what had happened was that 1981 to 90 was declared as the decade for development of mental health. And along with various other schemes that the United Nations had taken up, one of them was to identify which are the most important life skills that a person needs in order to lead a good quality of life. So they came out with 10 of them. And hats off to them, they did an extensive survey all over the world in different countries, different cultures, and finally came out with this conclusion of these 10. Today, I'm not going to talk about all 10 of them, but I'm going to talk about two of them. One is the ability for good decision making, and the other is the skill by which you can solve problems which you face. So decision making and problem solving are two of the life skills which the WHO of United Nations brought to our notice more than 30 years back, that these are essential aspects of living a good quality of life. Now, what happened was, many countries, after that United Nations report came, they started incorporating it into the curriculum of their mainstream education. But India has not yet done that. We have taken strides. We have, you know, very good handbooks available now for life skills to be taught to students. And many, many schools have started inculcating that in their regular routine. But the important point to note is it is not part of the mainstream curriculum. It is only taught more or less like an extracurricular activity, the same way as maybe you have debates or Model United Nations or some sports, athletics, theater. This has been brought in that category. So when that happens, there isn't sufficient push, there isn't sufficient motivation for people to actually take deep interest. In many cases, teachers, and because of the teachers, the students have taken a lot of interest, but simultaneously, there are a lot of places where it is done just as a formality. Have one class on that, finish it off. Children are laughing, giggling, not taking it seriously, and then moving on to their main subjects where they know that they have to study, they have to remember, they have to mug up, because that's where they, you know, their future lies and their marks will come and things like that. Anyway, that's only part of the issue. Today, I want to talk to you about decision making and problem solving. The first step in this is to be aware that there is a problem, to be aware that I have to take a decision. The second thing is to tell yourself, how urgent is it? There are certain decisions which have to be taken immediately. There are certain decisions which have to be taken sometime. You can do it now, You can do it tomorrow, you can do it next week, you can do it next month. So check yourself, any decision that you have to take, any problem that you are confronting with, what is the deadline? How soon do I have to do it? Based on that, you can make a plan. How much time will I put into it? How much effort will I put into it? How fast do I have to work on these things? Based on that, you take the next step forward. That is defining the problem for which a decision has to be taken. Be very clear, what is the issue on hand? What is the substance for which I need to take decisions? The second thing is to tell yourself that I have to take this decision. There are a lot of people who pass the buck. They keep expecting others to do it. They feel, why should I take all this responsibility? Fair enough. You want to do it that way? That's your choice. But remember, people who keep passing the buck, people who expect others to take responsibility, take decisions, and solve problems, they lose the ability of decision making. So when confronted with a situation where there's nobody else to help, it's only you and you who are going to take this decision, that is when you fail, because you have not practiced it beforehand. If you can start practicing or taking decisions, taking control over the situation, even when there is somebody else to do it, you are practicing. You are preparing yourself that tomorrow, if some serious situation arises, will I be able to tackle it or not? You yourself will get the answers, nothing very difficult. Then what I need to do is to understand that a decision can always be broken down into smaller parts. That's something I think we should always look for. Whatever the problem is, can I break it down into smaller parts? Sometimes a problem looks huge. It looks unsurmountable. But if I develop the habit of breaking it into parts, then number one, it becomes easier to tackle the first step. Number two, when I've tackled the first step, my confidence level goes up. And then I can move on to the second and third step. Just to give you an example, I've had situations where somebody comes and says, I've lost a job. I'm facing financial threat. I need to do something about it. I need to find out how to get a job. And the same person says, there is a recession in my industry. I'm not confident with my qualifications whether I'll get a good job or not. I feel that there are very few jobs available, or I feel nobody will give me the type of salary that I want. Now, when a person is stuck with a major problem that I have to take a decision with regard to getting a new job, it looks so huge, so difficult, that the person starts going down. And the more he feels helpless, the more he becomes pessimistic, the lesser is his decision-making ability. The lesser is the effort that he puts in. So, I'm just giving you an offhand example. If this person says, yes, I have a problem, I have to take a decision where to take up my next job. But what is the first step? So many years I was happy in whatever I was working on. So I don't have an updated CV, a bio data. The target number one is to make a good CV. If I can do that, then if somebody is willing to help or somewhere where there is a possible vacancy, I can immediately forward my CV to those people. So now things look much simpler compared to looking for a job. Once you make that CV, the second goal could possibly be, let me get it vetted by somebody who is an expert. I have a friend who is into HR, or I have a senior who has seen much more of life than me. Can I show this to that person and get a feedback? That's my next goal. Once I do that, and the person tells me, here 1, 2, 3 places you have to change. Once you do that, then you can start distributing that CV and start looking. Not only have I taken 2 steps forward, my confidence level goes up. That is what is a very simple thing which many people don't understand. Faced with a major decision-making or problem-solving situation, they get overwhelmed. They start thinking it is very, very difficult. And this happens more in what we refer to as non-programmed decisions. What are programmed decisions? Those for which my mind has been programmed, meaning to say, I have been solving similar problems. Let's say I work on the computer. There's something wrong. I'm not being able to connect to this StreamYard at 2 o'clock. I have to present this every live. Now, this is something which, let's say I've been doing it for years. I know exactly what to do. First, I have to test out this. I have to log in. If it's not coming on this laptop, can I check on my other laptop? Can I check through the mobile whether it's logging in from there or not? I'm used to it. So it's a programmed decision. Even if that is not happening, I call up my consultant, the person doing my maintenance of my laptop. And I ask him, hey, I'm not being able to log in. What do I do? Now he tells me A, B, C, D steps. So generally, programmed decisions, those which for which you have the expertise, you have the qualifications, you have the abilities, those you have no difficulty in solving. Many of us solve a number of problems in a day. But supposing the problem is completely different, for which I have not had a programming, there is no precedent. I don't know how to do this because I've never done it in my life. And then nobody to guide me or, advise me or control me. And that is when things become difficult. So please remember, practice as often as possible taking non-programmed decisions. If you make it a habit, then you will realize that things become much easier. Okay. I have a few basic points, which, as you know, we generally do, put it in audiovisual form so that it remains in your mind. You can even jot it down from there or photograph it or whatever it is. So Anis is now showing you these slides, starting with taking decisions when faced with a problem. When you are faced with an unusual problem, when you have to take, non-programmed decisions, what do? The first step I have just been talking to you, divide the problem. Put it into its parts, which make the whole. Every big problem, every insurmountable problem has got components, parts. if you put it into parts, each part doesn't look as difficult as the whole. So break it up. Then the next step would be collect data, get help from experts, people who really know the subject. There are so many who claim, oh, I have done this before, I know this. Check them out. Are they really experts? Do they really have that ability to guide you? If not, it is better to avoid such people. Similarly, read up from, underline the word reliable. Read up from reliable sources. You just Google over the internet or you go to ChatGPT. You'll get answers. Within a fraction of a second, you'll get answers. But how do you know those answers are reliable? In fact, at times it can even put you off. So make sure that you are reading up from authentic, reliable sources. And while doing that, separate perceptions from facts. What are perceptions? Perceptions are opinions, views, attitudes. But facts are facts. Facts are verifiable. It's not difficult to verify whether this particular thing that I have read up or this particular solution that I have been, you know, exposed to, is it real? Once all this data has been collected, then you move to the next step, that is introspect. Take time off and think. I already told you that in case there is a problem which has to be solved immediately, then the situation is different. But very often you will realize that you can take time. So set a deadline to your own self, and both subjectively and objectively introspect on the data available to you. Be emotionally stable. That's what I meant by saying objectively and subjectively. Objectively is logically. Subjectively is emotionally. So make sure that you are emotionally stable. Supposing I'm still very angry with my ex-boss who threw me out of the organization. I'm not emotionally stable. When I want to think, when I want to do something, what happens? All the time my thoughts keep going back to my ex-boss and my emotions are going on a roller coaster. When that is happening, inevitably I will take wrong and impulsive decisions. So please make sure you calm yourself down. Do whatever comes to you. It could be meditation, prayer, reading up something, taking deep breath, whatever you want to do. And then depending on the time available to you, take time off to think. Get away from your routine, get away from people. Put yourself in a situation where you have no distractions, nobody is coming and influencing you, and start thinking about the problem. Then you take your decision. But I always believe that when you take a decision, you should keep plan B in mind. Last few months, you have seen how there was so much of tension, so much of confusion for entrance exams, be it medicine, be it engineering, be it anything. Those who managed to handle the stress of these delays and confusion were those who had a plan B ready. Yes, this is my first goal. I've struggled for it. I'm continuing to struggle for it. And if I get it, I'm extremely happy. But for some reason beyond my control, I don't get it. Then I move to plan B. I already have an alternate, a substitute ready that itself brings down your tension, problem, whatever you want to call it. So in very simple terms, I just took you through step by step how you can, take a situation. But I come back to the main thing which I started off with. Definition of the problem, identification of the problem, or the issue if you need to take a decision. If I want to take a decision, should I do this or should I not do this? I have to focus only on that issue. Very often we get carried away by extraneous circumstances. And that is what creates and becomes a problem. If I can tell myself that yes, there is a problem, nothing is insurmountable. There is no such thing as an unsolvable problem. Always there is something or the other. There are ways and means, including if there is no way and mean to solve a problem, think of how you can cope with it. You develop the ability to cope, that itself takes you forward. You don't have to feel miserable. You don't have to feel cornered. Mentally tell yourself, yes, I am looking for solutions. I am identifying A, B, C alternatives. I will try and select whichever is the best. Let's say there is a situation for which there is no solution. You are bound and restricted into a situation where there's nothing you can do. It's not in your hands. That is when people get extremely upset. People start losing their balance. People become extremely emotional. They take impulsive decisions. That is what you need to protect yourself from. That I am going to learn ways and means of coping with a problem for which I am now convinced there is no solution. Very simple things. I can tell you this straight away from my experiences and my interactions. But in reality, you know what happens when people get tensed, when people are under stress, when people start believing that there is no solution and I am going to suffer, or some horrible things are going to happen to me, they lose their decision-making ability. When that sort of a situation comes, what you need to do is to look at the bigger picture. Today, I'm looking at the immediate problem. But life is beyond this problem, isn't it? Just think, 1 month back, 1 year back, 10 years back, you went through some difficult times. Try and recall one or two of them. When you were going through the issue, when you were facing the hurdles, how stressed out you were, how pessimistic you were, how miserable you were. But whatever you did, the issue went off. Maybe it went in your favor and you did very well. Or maybe you just managed to close it, even suffering some losses. But when you look back upon it now, it doesn't look as great or as formidable as it looked at that time, isn't it? Why? Because today you're looking at the bigger picture. You're telling yourself, life is not just that one problem that I faced. There are so many issues in life, both good and bad. There are so many times when I've progressed, so many times I've regressed, so many times when I've succeeded, so many times when I have failed. That is what life is all about, particularly when it comes to human behavior. So if I take up that stand that there is always something that can be done, then let me also, before I wind up the first half, also tell you about the important aspect that there are situations where you need not take a decision. Sometimes we get so overwhelmed that we take it upon ourselves that I have to resolve this. You're not a rescuer or savior for the rest of the world, right? There are situations where if you do not take the decision, if you do not solve the problem, what will happen? That is what we refer to as worst case scenario. Supposing I don't solve this problem, supposing I do not take any decision on this challenge that I am facing, what is the worst that can happen? And if that happens, how much will be my loss? Loss not just financially, but emotionally also. When I start thinking of the worst case scenario, you know, life doesn't look as bad as it looked till yesterday. I start accepting it that yes, probably, you know, this is the worst that can happen. The second part of it is, how likely is it that that worst case will actually hit me? You'll be surprised. Very often, the chances of total failure or major loss are very, very less. Statistically speaking, it is quite likely that the situation may not be what I call as the worst case scenario. Yes, there are going to be losses. Can I afford those losses? Can I move on regardless of those losses? And the moment I find I can do it, you know what I need to do? Cut your losses. That means stop the losses at the point at which it is now. If you see people who are gambling, for example, somebody takes a certain amount of money and goes into the gambling den. Sometimes he makes money, he's happy. Sometimes he starts losing. Now he knows that today I have lost a substantial amount of my savings. I still have enough left over. So if I cut my losses and if I say today's a bad day, I'm not performing well, maybe my mind is not working, maybe circumstances are bad, whatever may be the reason, but the fact is that I have been constantly losing. Can I cut my losses and stop the gambling? And gambling I'm only using as a a larger term. It could be people indulging in stock market, for example. It could be people dealing with real estate. Whenever such things are happening, it could be people investing into a relationship. You have invested into a relationship and it is going bad. Do you cling on to it? Do you say, because I took a decision to be in this relationship, even if it is causing me emotional losses, I will continue to invest in it? That is a very, very foolhardy thing to do. If you have the courage and the self-responsibility to say, yes, maybe I made a wrong decision and I see that I'm losing. I've already lost so much. Now can I put a full stop to this and move on to something else? Those are the people who in the long run, in a broader picture, inevitably succeed in life. So with that, I'll stop the first half of my session. Sonal is here to give you one or two very interesting updates of what's happening, and I'll be back in a minute.
Very good afternoon to everyone. So nice to see everybody on every Saturday. And today I have come to tell you two things. One is just to remind you that we offer free counseling at the academy, and we offer free counseling face to face, telephonic, as well as through email. So whomever you come across, you feel that, you know, this might be a useful information to them, just give that the information, but leave it to them to decide whether they want to come back to us or no. But let them know that such and such place is available, this facility is available, if they wish to take that opportunity to help themselves. Other than that, the next one, the second one, what I have come here for is, if you think that you want to be that person who wants to help other people, but for some reason you cannot come to the academy to get yourself trained, then we do have a wonderful offer called a course called International Program in Counseling and Guidance. This is a complete online program, right? And it is 1 year. It is very much self-paced, so you will get the lessons module by module. You will read the lessons, watch the videos. Along with that, you will have a mentor exclusively for you, who will be in touch with you as and when you need. You can get in touch with the mentor, have a very comfortable relationship, so that you know while you are reading the question, the modules, you have certain questions and you want to, you know, get some clarification, or some thoughts are there, some introspection is happening, you can talk to your mentor and get the advantage of it. Apart from that, you can even opt for a mentor with the language you are comfortable with. Isn't this a wonderful opportunity? Especially for people who have 6 days of work and cannot come to the academy to learn physically. Yes, we do have diploma in counseling skills for that. But for some reason, you have that quest to do something, but there are certain restrictions or certain constraints, then do think of International Program in Counseling and Guidance. And Anis will put up the phone numbers for you. Get in touch with us. Let us bring more and more people and have a harmonious society around us. Thank you.
When Sonal was talking about restrictions and all that, I was thinking how the universe seems to be conspiring against Saturdays. Last week, we missed out our FB session because of Ganesh Chaturthi. In October, we are going to miss out one session because of Dasera. And in November, we are going to miss out one session because of Diwali. All of them coming on Saturdays. In a way, to some people who work 6 days a week, I think it's been a good thing because they get a holiday just before Sunday. Since they have only 1 day off in a week, when a holiday comes on Saturday, it's convenient because it gives you a longer weekend. But to us, you know, who are all of us who are enjoying these FB Live sessions, it's very sad that, you know, in every month we are missing out one from September to October to November. But I'm sure after that, we will have a clear run. Every Saturday we will be there. And as I've already told you, we are fixing up topics well in advance. We've also got some very good suggestions from some of you, and we have incorporated that. So some of the topics that we have taken up, you know, our suggestions from you people, which I'm very happy that, you know, you had that sort of thinking, that you have given us, you know, very useful suggestions, and we have incorporated that. So at least a month or two in advance, we keep fixing up the topics so that I get a chance to prepare and consolidate whatever data or information that I have. You can see here, Anis has put up this slide. On 21st September, we are going to have a session on positive mental attitude, how to think positively, regardless of what circumstances you are going through. It's an attitude, a mental attitude, which you can program your mind to develop. And once you develop it, it remains with you. The Saturday after that is 28th September, where I have been looking at the utility or the usefulness of anger. The moment we say anger, people tend to think of it in a very negative manner, no? But I'd like to discuss with you on 28th September that anger can be very useful under certain circumstances, which we will discuss on that Saturday. And the week after that, that is on 5th of October, we will be talking about a very good suggestion which has come from Surekha, unfinished emotional business. Meaning to say that in our journey, which involves a lot of emotions and interpersonal relationships, what happens if something is left unfinished emotionally or mentally and life moves on? And then you suddenly realize that you have not come to what we call as a closure. How do you deal with that? And the week after that, of course, is Dasara, so we'll be taking a gap. And then we'll continue as usual every Saturday at 2 o'clock, 2 to 3. So now that we have moved on to the second session, we have the first remark from Roshan, who is now in Secunderabad. Roshan says, I decided to do my DCS at 70 plus. And today, I feel that my decision has taken me to improve my quality of life, made me to introspect and reach out to others, which gives me immense satisfaction. I have started a counseling center at home and go to a school to counsel students. What a great experience. The last three words have struck out Roshan, because who says you are in old age? Age is only as much as the numbers are. Roshan is saying that she decided to go for DCS post 70. We had a wonderful student called S.R. Krishnamurti who did DCS post 80. And for the next 12 years, he was an active volunteer in a hospital, in an old age home, and in our own Banjara center. He lived a wonderful life. Earlier, he had been a very senior and responsible banker in a very senior position. But he said that what I do as a counselor to me is far more meaningful than the work I did for my bank. Yes, decision making is hampered due to lazy and postponement. Very true. I'm glad you brought this up. Whenever we, you know, procrastinate, whenever we develop this habit of saying, I'll do it tomorrow, I will think over it, I'm a little busy now, I have other matters to settle, I'm not sure whether I'm on the right track or not, so I will think over it. Sometimes you know what happens, that thinking becomes brooding. And when that happens, you start going down further and further. That is what we refer to as procrastination. That is delaying taking a decision without any valid reason. Just saying that I'll do it later, I'll do it tomorrow, I'll do it next week. Please protect yourself from that habit. Surekha says, my extremely skilled but ego-invested cook refuses to take feedback when a dish is not made to my satisfaction. It's a never-ending conflict between me trying to convince him that the dish was not up to the mark and he insisting that it was simply perfect. This is a form of denial, you know, Surekha. A lot of people get into that. If he's a good cook, he has made a mark for himself. Generally, he makes food which everybody appreciates. He's got his reputation to protect. As you rightly said, he has now got an ego. And he may be making good food 8 times out of 10. But the 1 or 2 times when the food is not up to the requirements, if he has got a closed mind, if he refuses to take feedback, constructive criticism, and make modifications, you know what happens to such people? Their quality starts deteriorating. People start going away from them. Even though 8 times out of 10 they have been satisfied with his performance, that 1 or 2 times when it was bad and he is not even open to listening to you, people start drifting away. And that not only affects work, it also causes isolation, loneliness, you know, being away from people. Because when I want to convince him or request him that, you know, I'm giving you some constructive criticism and he's not doing it, what do I normally do? I don't want to have anything to do with him. Even if I see him coming on the road, I'll just turn off and walk off somewhere. Why get into a conflict with him when I know that he will not listen to me? That's a very dangerous type of a situation to develop. Wish something can be done about such people, right? Yes. Surekha also says, this boy was faced with the conflict of telling the truth about a close friend who had violated the law and hiding it out of his sense of loyalty to him. He faced conflict between truth versus loyalty. How can we help him resolve this issue within himself? See, loyalty, I'm a believer in, you may or may not agree, some of you, that loyalty cannot go beyond basic principles. Loyalty cannot go to the extent where, you know, you are protecting the other person regardless of anything. In fact, parents do that. If a parent is told that their child was seen doing something wrong, the loyalty to the child prevents the parent, even if it's a teacher telling them, they say, no, my child cannot do wrong. That is how they think that they are showing their loyalty to their child, anybody for that matter. But it is contraindicated. It is counterproductive. You are actually doing disservice to that person by being exceptionally loyal, even when the other person is doing wrong. The first step, I would say, is to, for this person to get hold of that other person who has broken the law and tell him, I will try to protect you as much as I can. But beyond a certain point, which goes completely against my morals and values, I cannot do that. So please forgive me. Tell me if there is something which is going to hurt you very badly, I will help you with that. But do excuse me. And I expect you also to do the same. If I am doing something wrong, please point it out to me. In the short run, I may have to suffer some punishment. But in the long run, I will become a better human being and the quality of my life will improve. Right? Yes. Mr. Ramchandra says, very help interaction and knowledge sharing in simple words. Thank you. Thank you very much. Whenever a genuine compliment like this comes, I feel very, very elated and inspired. Asha says, getting a knowledgeable third person perception to resolve issue is a good idea. To look at solution side more objectively. I will take that one more step ahead, Asha. Develop a panel of people who are experts in certain things. I may not be very good in finance and taxation and all that. So can I ensure that I have one knowledgeable, unbiased person who's a financial expert? When I have a problem, I will take help from him. One legal expert, one health-related expert, one emotions and human behavior related expert, one expert to deal with maybe children's studies or children's behavior. One expert to deal with geriatric or old age problems. When there is no issue, please start looking around and make an informal, in your own mind, a panel of such people. So when you're faced with a problem, when things are not going well, you know whom to reach out to. Yes, Dr. Sharayu from Dharwad. She says, courage to own consequences makes you bold in problem solving. Very true, Sharayu. Courage. It takes courage to say, I am going to go against the tide. I'm going to take a certain decision which will make me unpopular. I'm going to solve problems in my own way, which maintains my clear conscience, regardless of what people say. If I have that attitude, I can do wonders. Roshan says, without any help, I've taken steps to solve major problems, which otherwise seemed impossible. When there is no help, I truly believe in the divine, supreme being that gives you the wisdom to do the right thing. Yes. And that divine, that supreme being, you know, invades into your own mind and becomes part of you. You are not different from the divine. You become part of the divine, and thereby you take better decisions. Okay, Surekha says, sometimes we face a clash between our personal values and social norms or expectations. This is very evident in the dressing style of young girls these days. How can we help them decide to dress in ways that are modern but don't project themselves as eye candy? In most cases, Surekha, I've seen the problem goes beyond just dressing. That child, a growing young girl, has some issues. Maybe low self-esteem. Maybe she feels unloved. Maybe she feels lonely. We need to identify the cause, why she is using unacceptable means to attract attention. If you can spend time individually with each such girl, if there are 10 of them, 10 will have 10 different reasons. But with each of them, if I can find out, it could be rebelliousness against very strict parents. They are trying to control me. I'll show them by dressing in this manner. So deal with that problem. Identify that problem. Bring her close to you. Accept her as is there is. Don't make any remarks on her dressing or whatever else she is doing. And go into these issues. The more she can resolve that, the less are the chances that she will indulge in any such acts. Surekha also says, when I am in conflict as to what I should be doing, I ask myself, if my mother knew about this, what would she think? Yes, Surekha, that's a very good way of doing things. A lot of people, I also know who do it, that what I am doing, if my mother was standing next to me, would I still be doing the same thing? When you think of it in that way, and particularly so in the way Surekha says that her mother has raised her in a very principle-centered way, and this helps her to make the most peaceful choice every time. So your mother need not be physically next to you. It could be a mother, it could be a guru, it could be a parent, it could be just about anybody. That's not important. But the person who upholds values and principles, who has been a sort of mentor to you, who has molded you in what you are, visualize that person when you are taking a decision, and you will never take a wrong decision. Right? One more from Surekha. Sometimes we face a clash between our personal values and social norms or expectations. This is very evident in the dressing style of girls. I've already answered this. So seeing all these, what we need to do is to follow those very basic, simple steps that I've told you. And do it when you need to take very small decisions or when you're facing very minor problems. You practice that. I want to climb onto Mount Everest. Let me start with Nandi Hill. If I can climb Nandi Hill comfortably, then let me go to Western Ghats. If I can climb that, then let me go to Kanchenjunga. When I can climb that, then I go to Mount Everest. So everything has to be done step by step, progress, progress, and moving on. That is what life is all about. And this, as I said, is one of the basic life skills. Please work on it. If there's any doubt, any question, as Sonal also told you, we are there for all of you anytime anybody needs some clarification, some, you know, removing of confusion or some decision making. We are there to help you. But go ahead and do that. And I will be seeing you again next Saturday at 2 o'clock on the topic of positive mental attitude. Bye-bye.